In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer their prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as their creator and guide, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Vanity of vanities, says Qoheleth, vanity of vanities, all things are vanity. Here is one who has labored with wisdom and knowledge and skill, and yet to another who has not labored over it, he must leave property. This also is vanity and a great misfortune. For what profit comes to man from all the toil and anxiety of heart with which he has labored under the sun? All his days, sorrow and grief are his occupation. Even at night, his mind is not at rest. This also is vanity. The word of the Lord. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. You turn man back to dust, saying, "Return, O children of men." For 1,000 years in your sight are as yesterday, now that it is past, or as a watch of the night. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. You make an end of them in their sleep. The next morning, they are like the changing grass, which at dawn springs up anew, but by evening wilts and fades. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain wisdom of heart. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Fill us at daybreak with your kindness, that we may shout for joy and gladness all our days. And may the gracious care of the Lord our God be ours. Prosper the work of our hands for us. Prosper the work of our hands. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, if you are raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Think of what is above, not of what is on earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, your life, appears, then you too will appear with him in glory. Put to death, then, the parts of you that are earthly: immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and the greed that is idolatry. Stop lying to one another, since you have taken off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed for knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcision and uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to share the inheritance with me." He replied to him, "Friend, who appointed me as your judge and arbitrator?" Then he said to the crowd, "Take care to guard against all greed. For though one may be rich, one's life does not consist of possessions." Then he told them a parable. There was a rich man whose land produced a bountiful harvest. He asked himself, "What shall I do? For I do not have space to store my harvest." And he said, "This is what I shall do. I shall tear down my barns and build larger ones. There I shall store all my grain and other goods. And I shall say to myself, 'Now as for you, you have so many good things stored up for many years. Rest, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this night your life will be demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, to whom will they belong? Thus will it be for all who store up treasure for themselves, but are not rich in what matters to God. The Gospel of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, on the 18th Sunday of Ordinary Time, the Church's liturgy invites us to an examination of conscience, to examine our relationship with material things and money and with possessions and attachments in general. Wealth, money, material possessions, although these things are good, they are not eternal goods. Having an abundance of these things, money and possessions, does not guarantee God's favor and our salvation. In fact, there are several places in the Gospels where Jesus very strongly warns us to be on guard against wealth and greed, because they can be a real obstacle to spiritual growth and our overall well-being and happiness. The person who is wise does not invest his or her heart in the things of this world, because all of the things of this world have an expiration date. In other words, they will end. They are destined for the grave, for death and decay. Alexander the Great, who conquered so many lands and territories and acquired unfathomable riches and fame, took none of his wealth or possessions with him when he died, not a single coin. Likewise, the great pharaohs of ancient Egypt left behind all of their treasures of gold, precious jewels, and personal artifacts. They could take not a single one with them when they died. This is why in today's parable we see so clearly the foolishness of the man who seems obsessed with acquiring more and more wealth and storing it up. God said to him, "You fool, you fool. This night your life will be demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, to whom will they belong? So will it be," the Lord says, "for all who store up treasure for themselves, but are not rich in what matters to God." So the way God perceives riches is very different than the riches that the world perceives. We deceive ourselves if we think that our money and our possessions will bring us happiness and life. Some of the most miserable, unhappy people that I know have tons of money, tons of possessions. But no amount of money can buy us happiness. And no one and no nothing can give us the happiness and joy that God alone gives us. In our own day and age, there are many people who save all their money, invest well, devotedly follow the stock market, and are always on the lookout to make more money and acquire more property. They are very dedicated. But let us hope that they are more dedicated to God, more dedicated to charity and humility and the rest of the virtues than they are to their wealth and possessions. For us Christians, our real treasure, our only treasure, is Christ himself. St. Paul the Apostle tells us that our lives are hidden with Christ in God, and that we are to keep our eyes fixed on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. We must not allow ourselves to be distracted by the lure of this passing world. We must seek to be rich in what matters to God. Without love for others, without the works of mercy, without genuine humility, our lives are sterile and empty, very poor and barren indeed. Our love for other people should not be limited to formal gestures or pious sentiments, kind words, but should express itself in concrete acts of mercy and almsgiving. That was the firm conviction of the early Christians. The second century text, The Shepherd of Hermas, insists that the money saved through fasting is to be given to the widow, the orphan, and the poor. But almsgiving means more than this. It is not simply giving a $20 bill, or even a $100 bill, or some spare change to a homeless person. As one bishop puts it, almsgiving is to give not only our money, but our time, not only what we have, but what we are. It is to give a part of ourselves. The mere giving of money can often be a substitute and an evasion, a way of protecting ourselves from closer personal involvement with those suffering and in distress. On the other hand, to do nothing more than offer reassuring words of advice to someone crushed by urgent material anxieties is equally an evasion of our responsibilities. Bearing in mind the unity between man's body and soul, we seek to offer help on both the material and the spiritual levels at once. Whatever we give to others in terms of mercy and almsgiving, however we practice almsgiving and charity, we must remember is always a free gift from the grace of God. We have no prayer, no mercy, no compassion, no charity, no almsgiving, but what God Himself gives us and bestows on us to share. So we must pray for all these gifts, these virtues, these graces. In the end, at the end of our lives, we will be judged on charity. Did we use our money to fill our days with useless entertainment and indulge our selfishness? Or did we use our money responsibly to assist the needy and to build up the church and to help others? Did we give until it hurts for the sake of Christ? Or were we stingy and selfish during our earthly lives? Do we have our hearts set on the passing things of this world or on the things of heaven, which will last forever? These are the questions and the choices that lay before us today and every day of our lives. Whoever has charity is rich. Whoever does not have charity is truly poor. We do well to put into practice the teaching of St. John Chrysostom, who said, "The rich person is not the one who possesses much, but the one who gives much. For whatever he or she gives remains forever." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, for our needs and those of the world, as we bring our petitions to the Lord. For the Vicar of Christ, for the successors of the apostles, and for all who preach and teach the Catholic faith, that the Spirit of truth and love may guide and fortify them in their mission, we pray to the Lord. For all peoples and nations torn by strife and civil unrest, that the Lord may grant his peace and the spread of the gospel, we pray to the Lord. For persecuted Christians throughout the world, especially in the Middle East, that the Lord may raise up faithful witnesses and defeat the wicked, we pray to the Lord. For all the members of this parish, that God may inspire, support, and complete our efforts by his grace, we pray to the Lord. And we pray for the intention of our seminarian, Jose Munoz, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray to the Lord. For all the souls in purgatory, that the dew of God's mercy and consolation may rest upon them, we pray to the Lord. Eternal Father, grant us the good things we need to serve you and others, and protect us from evil on our pilgrimage through this life. We ask this through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Graciously sanctify these gifts, O Lord, we pray, and accepting the oblation of this spiritual sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Thank you.
the mystery of faith. We proclaim your death. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Accompany with constant protection, O Lord, those you renew with these heavenly gifts, and in your never-failing care for them, make them worthy of eternal redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this valley of tears. Turn then, most gracious Advocate, thine eyes of mercy towards us, and after this our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary, pray for us, O Holy Mother of God. Let us pray. O God, our refuge and our strength, look down in mercy upon thy people who cry to thee, and by the intercession of the glorious and immaculate Virgin Mary, Mother of God, of Saint Joseph, her spouse, of thy blessed apostles Peter and Paul, and of all thy saints, do thou mercifully and graciously hear the prayers which we pour forth for the conversion of sinners, and for the liberty and exaltation of our Holy Mother, the Church, through the same Christ our Lord. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus.